The electric field also becomes a center because it has to turn it up.
If electric field goes off in the menu,
Okay, let's be started. We have a large task to accomplish in the next two lectures. Basically, I'm going to try to jam as much of five lectures as I can into two. So it's going to go pretty fast, but I sent a large number of links. Especially today, I sent you a link to some PDF of UGRAPH's PowerPoint presentation from Professor Ruger's textbook. He's at the University of Michigan. That's the textbook that's usually used in his class, but I don't favor it. But it has some nice pictures, and it has some nice online tools you can use to study various things in the app. So, based on the textbook is where I'm going to finish the course with, which is transmission lines. Transmission lines are aimed at least two conductor system for conveying electromagnetic wave force. So it's a type of a waveguide structure. It's everything from the coax cable of the internet service to the little tiny strip lines that are on radio frequency integrated circuits to the 700,000 volt transmission lines crisscrossing the United States. Those are all transmission lines, okay? And we're going to do a quick analysis of them. Rudimentary EM. Remember, we were able to calculate capacitance and inductance of structures. So for example, consider a two-wire transmission line, like this, and has some spacing D between the centers of the conductors. There is some material parameter that it may be embedded with, the dielectric permittivity epsilon, and perhaps a permeability mu. And the wires will have a diameter P. Okay? You can then, through the standard techniques that we've discussed, analyze the capacitance per unit length of the structure. Okay? And we're going to give that the nomenclature C prime. And that turns out, we're not going to go through the analysis, but you can find this in many textbooks, I believe, including our own. It has this kind of a format to it. And the units are farads per meter. Okay? So that's the capacitance per unit length of a pair of wires. These wires also have inductance per unit length. In other words, you can store for any currents, time harmonic, time varying fields propagating down that transmission line. You can also store energy in the magnetic field, and therefore you can calculate equivalent inductance for the thing. Call this L pi. This is given by mu over pi times the natural log of the same thing that's in the denominator up there, plus the square root of mu over pi squared minus 1. And this has units of Henry's per meter. Okay? So that's what a two-wire transmission line looks like. Now, that would be, for example, a very common type transmission line in the old days of television. When you had an antenna on your roof, you would run a flat pair of two-wire conductor embedded in plastic so that it looked like this. And it was held together with a plastic sheet around it. And that's sometimes called a twin lead. Yeah.
Is an electromagnetic pole I'm just heard?
Yep. Yeah. Everything within this bracket. Yep. Okay. A more common type of transmission line is the coaxial line. We've looked at static coaxial cables, for example. And so we take the inner radius as A and the outer radius as D. And we assume this is surrounded perhaps with a dielectric and magnetic material with permittivity and permeability, mu and epsilon mu respectively. We can calculate the capacitance per unit length. This. And we've done this. We call this C prime again. This is P pi epsilon divided by natural log of the phrase. And similarly, we can calculate the inductance of the unit length. We call that L pi, and this is mu over 2 pi times the natural log B over A. Okay. Now, in addition to capacitance and inductance per unit length for these two prototype transmission lines, real conductors inside the lines are going to have finite conductivity. Okay? So they're going to, in fact, have resistance per unit length as well. Although it tends to be very low, it's often negligible. For the two-wire line, resistance per unit length we call R prime, and this is given by 2 pi R sub s, I'm sorry, 2 R sub s over pi d. The units are ohms per meter, and this term Rs is given by the square root of pi times the frequency times the permeability of the conductor, mu sub c, divided by sigma c, where sigma is the conductivity of that conductor. And for a coaxial system, it's a similar expression. The resistance per unit length, R prime, is given by that same Rs divided by 2 pi times 1 over A plus 1 over B. See that having large diameter or large radius conductors in a coaxial system lowers the resistance. Why? Because you've got more area for the current to travel. That's not quite the end of the story, because in the intervening material, which has some dielectric permittivity epsilon and the inherent permeability mu, you also might have some conductivity between those two conductors in that material. Okay. It's not going to be very high, it's going to be very low in good dielectric material like Teflon, for example, is an excellent material. In any event, you can talk about conductance per unit length. Conductance between those conductors allows current to leak between the conductors, the outer conductor, the inner conductor, the coax, for example. And in a two-wire line, going to call this G prime. This is given by pi sigma divided by the natural log of V over 3 plus the square root of V over 3 squared minus 1. And this has units of Siemens per meter. The old units were inverse ohms, sometimes called modes. And in a coax system, G prime is given by 2 pi sigma divided by natural log of also Siemens per meter. Okay? Now, there are many types of transmission line structures, but these are really two of the most common. The third most common is called the microstrip line, which you actually deposit on a printed circuit board. And the analysis of that is not straightforward, but be aware that it's an important technology. Yes? Conductivity.
Yes. So that's a two-wire line?
Just up here.
Yeah. Okay. So now, why do we make these equivalent circuit parameters? Okay, these capacitance, inductance, and resistance. We're going to now leave the world of electromagnetic waves, and we're going to go back to circuit concepts. Okay. So we're going to make an equivalent circuit of this device, of these devices, these transmission lines, based on calculations of these parameters, okay? So, we're going to draw an equivalent circuit of this transmission line. This is R prime delta Z. That's the resistance per unit length times an increment of length delta Z. That's going to be in series with an inductance given by the inductance per unit length times the unit length delta Z. That's going to come to a node, and I'm going to call this first node, node N. And over here will be node N plus 1. Okay? And there's going to be two components in shunt, or in parallel, if you like, with this. This is going to be the conductance per unit length times the length element delta Z. And capacitance per unit times the length element delta Z. And this is going to be our equivalent circuit for a line length delta Z. We're going to give this a positive and negative terminal representation. And we're going to talk about the voltage here at V at point Z as a function of time. And at the output, we're going to have a voltage here, plus minus, we're going to call V of Z plus delta Z at a time T. Okay, so that's the voltage at the output terminals. This is the voltage at the input terminals for the section of line delta Z. Yeah?
So for the, just, I'm a little confused about what G is, so I should always assume that G is just a resistor.
Yes, but we conductance is the inverse of resistance.
Okay,
so we're going to write it as a conductance per unit length because it'll make Kirchhoff's laws look prettier. So we can deal with conductances in parallel and geometrically or and algebraically, right? Resistances don't, so that's why we do it. It just makes the equations easier. Okay, node N plus 1. We'll have a current going in, we'll call I of Z and C. And at the output, we'll have I of Z plus delta Z, T. What else do we have here? Okay. So, we're going to apply Kirchhoff's voltage law around this loop, number one. So by Kirchhoff, the sum of the voltage rises or drops around the closed loop vanishes, right? So we can write that the sum of voltage drops or rises is always zero. Well, I'm going to use voltage rises, it doesn't matter. I start with V of Z of T, there's a rise from ground to there, and then I traverse once around the loop. Minus R prime, delta Z, times I of Z of T, because the current flowing into the resistor makes a voltage rise across it, or drop in this case. Minus L prime, delta Z, the voltage across the inductor depends on the time derivative of the current. And then the last voltage rise is a drop, V of Z plus delta Z of T. And all of this sums to zero. Okay? Now the next thing we're going to do is Kirchhoff's current law into this node. So we have current flow into this node and out of this node. So this is number two over here. Okay? So we're going to count of all the currents flowing into there. And so number two, we have Kirchhoff current law, which says that the sum of all currents into a node vanishes, okay? Because you can't have charge piling up somewhere. And you should be able to do this from your basic circuit theory. One occurrence into that node is I of Z of T, minus one that's leaving, which is G prime delta Z times V of Z plus delta Z of T, minus another one that's leaving, which is C prime delta Z times V of Z, partial derivative with respect to time of voltage V of Z plus delta Z times time, minus the current that's heading outward there, which is I at Z plus delta Z, and all of that sums to zero. Okay? That's our starting point. All right, where do we go from here? It's a big trick when you're developing the equation for the transmission lines. We've got it set up now that we understand all the voltage and current relationships for a line like delta Z. What we're going to do is we're going to combine them in such a way that delta Z goes to zero, and these difference equations that we've written become differential equations. That's what we always do. Okay? So we're going to rearrange those equations so that we can read off derivatives, right? So the trick is, rearrange, and make terms here as V of Z plus delta Z minus V of Z and T divided by delta Z. Okay? So we can do that by dividing through by delta Z, and then we take the limit as what? Delta Z goes to zero. And then this becomes the derivative, V of Z and T, dz. Okay? And when we do that, we get two equations, the first of which reads minus partial V Z and T with respect to Z is equal to R prime I of Z and T plus L prime partial I of Z and T with respect to T. Okay? That's one equation. First one, converted to this differential equation. The second one is minus partial I of these are very famous pair of equations called the telegrapher's equations. In the time of Before the first equations of time. Now, these equations are valid for any type of voltage or current on the line that you want to express in the line at the end of the line. We want to confine ourselves to a simple type of solution to this, time harmonic solutions, okay? Other than sines and cosines. So we want to investigate solutions that are going to stay stable. Sinusoidal waveforms. Okay? Which means that we're going to assume sines or cosines of one frequency, one and only one frequency. As such, that frequency will be redundant if we're carrying through every single equation from now on. So we're going to use phasor notation. E to the j omega t. And by the way, I'm going to use e to the j omega t now, whereas everything I've done with fields is e to the I omega t. J equals I in my world, it's the square root of minus one. Okay? Because those books are split halfway to your side, so I apologize. But anyway, we're going to let d of g and t be given by the real part of the complex expression v tilde of c. E to the j omega t. And we're going to let I of c be the real part of capital I to the tilde of c e to the j omega t. These complex coefficients are called phasor amplitudes. You ought to be familiar with them by now. Show of hands, anybody not seen this notation yet? Oh, that's a relief. Good. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to install those time steady-state sinusoidal waveforms, or if you like, complex time harmonic terms, up into our Schrödinger's equations. And we install them. Then this becomes partial d of c of t with respect to t. So then this derivative will become the real part of c d tilde with respect to t, e to the j omega t. Okay? And the derivative partial I of c of t with respect to t, sorry, this should have been with respect to c, becomes the real part of I tilde of c with respect to c. I'm sorry, I did need to grab this. Pardon me, I'm jumping one step ahead of myself here. We are concerned with a derivative with respect to time to obtain the first equation of the IDT. And the second one equation, we're going to take the derivative. Back to space. So I don't have myself there. This is the real part of I tilde of z. And the derivative of e to the j omega t is j omega e to the j omega t. Okay? And with that, the voltage equation becomes as follows. Becomes minus the real part plus R prime capital I z plus L prime times the derivative with respect to t, which is j omega times I tilde z. And we bracket all of this. What's common to all of these, you see, is that each of the j omega t term and this vanishes. Okay. Now notice that it's only the coefficient here that needs to vanish in order to satisfy this equation. So in effect, we get rid of the e to the j omega t dependence, and we only have a differential equation for the spatial variation of the voltage and current. Because I wrote it wrong. Thank you very much. This was supposed to be the first term up there, and she's absolutely right. Worried about getting through not enough material. My eyes keep scattered and scanning our page here. Okay? That means that really all we have to do to satisfy this equation is to have the stuff in brackets and braces vanish, so we can write minus dV tilde. Is equal to R prime, put this on the other side, R prime plus J over L prime times I tilde of C. And if we go through the same exercise converting the current equation, the derivative of the current with respect to C, by substituting in V and I, and taking the derivative with respect to C here, respect to T there, we get another equation that looks very similar to this. And this reads minus D I over C with respect to C is given by G prime plus J omega C prime times D tilde. These are called the telegrapher's equations. In phasor form. Notice the beautiful symmetry. Okay, where do we go from here? We have two coupled first-order differential equations. They're connected to each other because this equation has V, but it also has I. This equation has I, but it also has V. So we would like to uncouple them and look for solutions that satisfy the two uncoupled equations for voltage and current. Okay? So what we do is we differentiate again and substitute. Doesn't really matter, but we'll do dz first. dz, differentiate again, and substitute. See what happens if we differentiate this equation with respect to z, we get dz squared. Over here, we get a dz. And we substitute dz into there, and then I goes away. And we're left with d squared dz. Z squared is equal to a coefficient times v. So now we have a single second order uncoupled differential equation in the variable dz. So we've obtained the voltage equation, now uncoupled. Minus d squared d tilde of z. Is equal to R plus J omega L prime times, well, let's see. I'll do the extra step here. D squared I of C. I dz. And now we will substitute for dI dz here. And this becomes R prime plus J omega L prime. In fact, since this had a minus sign, this becomes plus d squared d over z squared. And we can do that again with respect to the current equation, and you get d squared I z with respect to d squared I.
equal to R prime plus J omega L prime G prime plus J omega C prime times I to omega Z. These are identical second order differential equations, constant coefficients, homogeneous equations. Therefore, they should have the same solution, right? So we're looking for solutions that are identical. But we're going to write these down in slightly more compact form because this is what we're going to be using for a lot of the rest of our work. We can rewrite this as d squared d tilde, so we can respect c squared, minus gamma squared d tilde c is equal to 0, d squared d of c, I of c. Factors in square minus one squared I tilde 0. These are identical differential equations. Well, in fact, these are wave equations. And this coefficient gamma squared.